Hey everybody, it's Joe. Before we get started, I just want to remind you, if you haven't already, to please subscribe to The Trap Set on iTunes or your favorite podcast app. And while you're at it, give us a review. It'll help other people find the show. All right, let's do it.
This episode of The Trap Set is brought to you in part by Colectivo Coffee, handmade coffee since 1993. Check them out online at colectivo.com.
This is Joe Wong. Welcome to The Trap Set, where each week we explore the lives of drummers. I want to play something for you. You're hearing Surrender by Cheap Trick, featuring my guest, Bun E on drums. Formed in Rockford, Illinois in 1973, Cheap Trick began as a hard-working regional band, relentlessly touring the Midwest club circuit. The band signed to Epic Records in 1976, but their early recordings were initially met with relative indifference by U.S. audiences. That changed thanks to their triple platinum live album, Cheap Trick at Budokan. Cheap Trick has influenced countless bands, and Bunny's driving and hook-laden drumming is fundamental to their success. A perfect pop drummer, he always plays just enough, never too much, never too little. And he makes his distinctive presence felt while always serving the song. In 2010, Bun E had a falling out with the other members of Cheap Trick that resulted in a lawsuit and ultimately a settlement. Although he still owns a membership stake in the band, he's no longer their active drummer. But he has found other creative outlets, such as the supergroups Tinted Windows and Candy Gold. He's also an avid drum collector. I interviewed him at his home in Rockford, Illinois, surrounded by his impressive collection of Ludwig drums. And now our interview with Bun E.
You know, when I heard The Twist, 1962 or three, my brother had a single of it, and I remember sitting down playing it about a dozen times and wondering what the hi-hat was and stuff. So that was the first. And then Return to Sender, I remember, was a shuffle, and the drums were, like, really cool on there, and I was just like, oh, this is pretty cool. Yeah.
So you were already sort of picking out the different components of the drum set before you sat down at a drum set.
Kind of, yeah. Then 1964, the Beatles were on TV. And about a month before that, they were kind of went on the air on the radio, and that's when it all took a big turn.
And so Ringo was the first guy that you saw on television and really wanted to emulate.
Yeah, well, in 63, I went to a band concert at my older brother's high school, and they had a thing at the end of the show where three drummers played all at the same time, and I just remember that was like the coolest thing I'd ever seen. And then from then on, I was like, you know, I gotta get into this drumming thing.
Mm-hmm. Did you have aspirations to become a professional drummer before it was obvious that that was a real possibility?
No.
So that was never really a dream. It was like a hobby, and then you were planning on going into the roofing business.
Yeah, you know, from 1966 through 68, I probably played twice every weekend. And like if there was a week off for Easter break or something, we'd play five or six of the eight or nine nights off. We worked a lot and started practicing, but I never thought I'd be on a concert stage or anything like that.
So tell me about how you met Cheap Trick.
Well, Rick was in class of 67. Tom was class of 68. I was class of 69. And we all went to same junior high school and high school. So I kind of knew these guys. I knew Rick because his dad owned a music store, and when he moved to town, he threw rocks at my sister when he was in sixth grade. And
that must have meant that he liked her.
He didn't like her.
Okay.
And I remember hearing, you know, that Nielsen kid, and da 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 da. And I used to hear that around the house. And then, so we were all in different bands. He was in the Grim Reapers, and Tom was in Toast and Jam when we all went to high school. Then after high school, you know, the guys that kept playing and the good guys kind of gravitate. You know, and everybody else falls by the wayside.
Do you remember the first time you played with those guys? Was there like a magical connection immediately?
there wasn't a magical connection. Their drummer got up and took off one night, and they're like, can anybody drum? I was like, yeah, I can, and they knew me, so I got up and played, and it would be like that. I would sit in once in a while or something. Rick had a great record collection, and so did Tom, and we dug all of the same bands, all these goofball weirdo English bands and stuff, so...
What was the kind of stuff you were listening to?
Well, you know, we like stuff that normal people didn't hear, like The Family and The Move and Pato, or just goofball bands. You know, when you get tired of hearing the regular stuff and you look for more and you start discovering stuff.
And when do you feel like it started to gel as a band?
Well, probably in 1972 is kind of when the band was Stooky, and me and Rick and Tom started, and the name of that band was Sick Man of Europe, which didn't get us a lot of good gigs, but that's when things started to kind of gel, when we got together and practiced for 6 hours a day.
Yeah. What would you do for the 6 hours?
Rick was writing original songs, and unlike the stuff in Cheap Trick, the verse and chorus would be 4-4, then it would go into some prog rock part or something, because we were all into like prog rock bands at that point, so you'd get into some dance floor clearing instrumental part and play that, and then go back to the song. So, and some of these songs were like 12 minutes long, so yeah, practice could, learning this stuff took a while.
Did you go to college?
I went to college for 2 years to stay out of Vietnam.
Uh-huh.
And then I got drew on lucky number 51, and then Nixon canceled the draft. The draft law expired. Nixon canceled it for Christmas, and suddenly I wasn't going to get drafted, and that's when I said, you know, Dad, I'm going to take a vacation and go visit Rick out in Philly, Rick and Tom, and went out there for about a week and then came home and said, Dad, I'm quitting the family business and getting in this band. I want to give this a shot.
Was your dad hurt by that?
No, he was all like, well, you know, there might not be a job when you come back. And I was like, yeah, okay, see ya.
What is he going to do, have another son?
Well, there were a couple under coming up from behind me, yeah, you know, so... Yeah, he was probably a bit miffed about it, but didn't bother me one bit, you know.
When did it feel like the band's original material was really good to you?
1975 was probably, I remember we'd play a place like Hump and Hannah's in Milwaukee. We'd play a long weekend there, like a Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and we'd learn a new batch of tunes. Rick would show, we'd practice with a new batch of tunes, and we'd take them up there for a four-nighter to try them out, and... We had a big...
Where was that?
It was on North Street. It was in a basement.
North Avenue?
Yeah, North Avenue. It was in a basement. It's gone now. Massive gay following there.
Ah.
We played Stone Toad, some places in Milwaukee where they wouldn't hire us back because too many gays came in.
What was it? Was it Robin's Look or something like that?
Robin and Tom's Look and me and Rick's Look. They liked the band. They liked to dance to us. Deaf people loved to dance to us. There was a deaf club next to the Stone Hearth, I remember, Stone Toad. They loved to dance to us because we were loud and they could feel the music and stuff. And we played all these different places in Milwaukee, and kind of Hump and Hannah's took us to heart. And Lenny, I remember this guy, was running the place. And
was anybody in the band homophobic at that point?
Nah. There was a saying in the music business. Some record guy told us this long ago, and he goes, listen, you guys, someone made a gay joke, and he goes, listen, you guys, fags buy records too. I was like, okay. You know, don't make any homo jokes. They buy records, you know. They were customers, so nah. But boy, people got ticked off about it. Like, in, you know, Milwaukee, they liked us the way we looked. If we went down to, like, Macomb, Illinois, we'd almost get killed and stuff. Mm. Yeah, they didn't
like that progressive Milwaukee, man.
Milwaukee was a center of civilization in the Midwest, you know, for back then.
Yeah, you know. Well, they had a socialist mayor at some point, maybe around then, too.
And so did Madison. I mean, yeah. Madison was like Hippieville, you know, and stuff. But,
well, I grew up in Milwaukee, and I can tell you for sure that there's still plenty of homophobia there. So
that's that famous German tradition. We'll throw you in jail for jaywalking. Yeah.
How did you get the deal for the first record?
Well, we knew guys from Epic from Fuse days, and we were talking to the college rep that was in Madison when we had Zeno, and he was like, "Well, you need a." They say, you're not quite there. Okay, fine, you know. So we got Robin in the band. I remember in May of 75, we opened for Lou Reed in Madison. And we brought an open reel machine and taped the show. And it was 45 minutes of original stuff. And about that same month, though, I remember we opened for Fleetwood Mac, the new Fleetwood Mac up
with
in
Lindsay and
La Crosse.
Stevie.
Yeah, they'd been together about 2 months. And it was before they were famous, so. And so we'd been on a couple concert stages and stuff, and we had a tape to kind of schlep around, and Mercury heard it, and they were interested. And then we got a hold of Epic and said, look, in the summer of 75, and said, Mercury's interested, we'd rather be with Epic, because the Yardbirds were on Epic, you know. Mm-hmm. And back in the day, we thought that was cool. And we approached the record, and then we went out to L.A. and did a weekend at the Starwood in November 75, and I had to call up labels and had them come see the band.
What did you notice once the album came out, once the first album came out?
Well, before it came out, there was at the record convention thing, they were overhyping us in the company. We were a little bit concerned. They were like, we got this little promo video they sent around, and one guy was going, these guys are going to be bigger than the Beatles. And we were like, yeah, well, we're fucked, you know.
And you didn't believe it.
Well,
I mean, lots of bands would have believed that.
Well, that's a kiss. It was like being called a new Bob Dylan, though. It's like the kiss of death, you know.
Right.
It's like, because no one's ever going to be bigger than the Beatles, or, you know, you can't compare people to that stuff. So yeah, the first album came out, and then it didn't get on the radio, you know, because it was a little too rockin' for radio. It was too hard, and the booking agency put us out with the Kinks for 2 weeks. Well, it was about a 4-week tour with the Kinks, where Ray wanted kickbacks every night. So halfway through the tour, he threw us off the tour.
What kind of kickbacks did he want?
About $500 a night to be on the tour.
What would he do with that?
Put it in his pocket. Well, that's show business, you know. Uh-huh. Give me some money. You can open for us. Give me some money.
Did you ever demand kickbacks from your opening acts after that?
Nah. we weren't like Ray.
Did you guys ever leave Rockford? Did you ever move out after that?
Nah.
And did anybody ever try to get you to move to L.A. or New York or whatever?
Nah, but we never, when we came out, we didn't say we were from Rockford. Because it was like, well, we're not going to say we're from Rockford, because who cares about Rockford? People will go, we're from Rockford, so what?
And right.
So you just
wouldn't say where you're from.
So we met with this guy at Epic to write the bio, and this guy's name was Eric von Lustbader.
You're talking about the bio that came out with the press release
for biography,
the first album.
Yeah. These guys, you know, these guys have no past. This guy's a comic book character and all that. This guy, he later wrote all his ninja books, Eric von Lustbader.
Okay.
He's a New York Times best-selling author and all that, but he worked for Epic at the time. So he said, let me talk to you guys, and I'll come up with a bio. And Rick and Tom were like, yeah, we used to go to Europe every summer and buy records. You know, okay, you met in France. You know, okay, yeah, whatever. You know, and I, Bun E. Carlos, okay, you'll be from South America now.
When did you take on the moniker Bun E. Carlos?
People call me Bun from about the time I was like 4, because I liked Paul Bunyan when I was a little kid.
Ah, got it.
Then Tom started calling me Bun E or Bunny.
And then when did it become Carlos?
Right when Cheap Trick started, and we were like going to try and get a record deal. I was like, well, we got a Nielsen, we got a Peterson. It sounds like the band of Swedes here. And so I said, yeah, I'm gonna change my name.
Did anybody actually think that you were Latino at any point?
Yeah, this teacher brought her class of Venezuelan students, Venezuelan language students from the U of I. Like before her first album came out, she brought them all to this gig in Bloomington or Champaign or someplace, and to show them that a Venezuelan could come to America and do good. All this, and I was just like,
Did they ever find out?
Not from me.
Good. So the same year as your first album came out, you released the second album.
Yeah, the first album came out like in March. We went in June to do the second album. CBS found us a producer named Tom Werman. This guy can get you on the radio. He got Ted Nugent on the radio, so he can get you guys on the radio. And And then they go, yeah, we're yanking him off this new guy. He's supposed to do this guy Eddie Money. We're going to yank him off that for your record. And we heard Bill Graham, you know, he was managing Eddie. Bill Graham was like, those motherfuckers and Cheap Trick, they'll never work for me. You know, we were just like, oh, good. Now we pissed off Bill Graham.
Did you ever play at the Fillmore after that?
Yeah, we played a Bill Graham gig in August with Kiss.
Oh, okay.
We were just like, oh, we're going to get killed here. You know, our dressing room is going to be like a garbage can in the alley or something. Bill Graham was a perfect gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
He was, so, yeah.
So how did the second album do in comparison?
Well, it got the lead review in Rolling Stone in the issue where Elvis died and his picture was on the cover. So everybody bought that Rolling Stone. And when they got to the record reviews, there was our picture. And the guy said something like, this is much better than that Seven Women on My Mind type of stuff, or an Eagle Slam and all that. And so that helped. It didn't put us over the top or anything. And we had I Want You to Want Me on there, but Tom Werman had this great arrangement he thought was better than our version. And that got put out as a single and went, didn't do anything.
So it's 1978, Heaven Tonight comes out. Creatively, it's a high point, but it's not selling like you thought it would. And then you get word that people in Japan are going crazy for it. How does the Japanese tour come about?
I Want You to Want Me and Clock Strikes 10 became hit singles. And so suddenly, hey, you guys are selling records in Japan. You know, you should go over there for a tour. You know, this guy's promoter called. You know, so off we went.
And when you landed, you were received basically like the Beatles when they came to the United States.
Yeah, it was pretty
cool. Were
you
expecting that?
No, we heard there might be some girls at the airport, you know, and I was like, oh, yeah, great, you know, 10 girls at the airport or something, you know, some fans or something like that, you know, and it was all screaming people and run you out the back door and get you in a car, you know, and shoot you to the hotel, and there's these cars pulling up next to us with fans, you know, pounding on the windows and doing all, you know, all that kind of junk.
Was it fun?
For about an hour, yeah.
Did it make you glad that you weren't the Beatles at that point? And that wasn't your reception everywhere in the world?
Yeah, the screaming thing was real neat. And then you can't leave your hotel room. Wow, why not? You know, you can't go down the lobby. There's 500 girls down there. Okay, so you're stuck in your hotel room. You can't look out your window. Why not? Because they might look up and back into the street and get hit by a truck. You can't look out your window. You know, it was that kind of junk. So that 2 weeks of that, you'd go nuts.
Did you have a girlfriend at the time? Or were you married?
Not a steady, no.
So did you guys fool around? Did you have fun?
Yeah, they were like 13-year-old Japanese girls.
Wouldn't have stopped some people,
we were
I
like
guess.
25-year-old human beings, you know, so they were half our age, a lot of them. But
Up until this point, had you fallen into the trappings of being rock and roll stars at all? Like, had you gotten into drugs? Had you drank too much?
No, we
slept
really,
around?
Well, we all knew how to drink too much from... Even before Cheap Trick, I'm sure, just from being kids and stuff. I wasn't a big drinker, you know.
Was there a big drinking culture in Rockford?
Not really. Illinois was 21. You know, if you wanted to drink, you went to Wisconsin where it was 18.
Well, yeah, obviously there's a big drinking culture there.
So, you know, Cheap Trick was always pretty good about pretty much being sober and pretty straight on stage. And it was a lot easier to do the gig that way, you know. I know in Japan on that first tour, the roadies were, they were trolling a lot of women and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And did the handlers and promoters over there kind of curate the experience for you and take you around?
Well, there wasn't too much going anywhere because it was too much trouble. It was pretty much gig or hotel 90% of the time. The Rainbow had done a tour in Japan, Blackmore's Rainbow, in 75, and a girl got killed at the concert. So there hadn't been any concerts in Japan for like 2 years. And Cheap Trick and Kiss were the first two acts to play there in like 2 years. And so people were all freaking out about the concerts. And the police in Japan are all federal. They're not local. So they had all these federal police at the concerts. And they had these little metal bars about 15, 16 inches long, about the size, thick as your finger. And if some fan got up, they'd walk over and go, doink, right on the head. That's like getting your bell rung. That thing would really hurt. And it was like that at all the shows. These screaming girls, but if they got out of the seats, the crap hit the fan. One show, they swarmed the stage, and we had to put the gear down and run.
Mm.
And the gigs were just amazing because we were just like, we could.
That, was it that the was most cool. enthusiastic audience you'd ever had?
Yeah, it was all screaming girls all night long, and
it didn't get annoying at any point. It was always great.
Well, yeah, and like I Want You to Want Me, they'd go crying, crying, crying. They would drown out the band. We couldn't hear ourselves, so that was like, whoa. So that was something different. And my roadie'd be sitting about 3 feet from me, and I'd have to yell at him so he could hear me and stuff. And so that was kind of cool, you know. And of course, then I was like, no one's going to believe this when we go back home. You know?
Were those the biggest shows you've ever played?
We'd done arena shows in the U.S. and stuff, so, you know.
As a headliner?
Probably. In Japan, they only had one big room. That was Budokan. That held like 10,000 people. Everything else was theaters, and they held like 1,500 to 2,000, except for Osaka had one that held about 3,500.
At this same time, there was the ascension of punk rock, and I think lots of those bands were heavily influenced by Cheap Trick. Lots of the punk rockers kind of had to disavow their affinity for other rock bands of the 70s, but Cheap Trick was still cool. But then, as you moved into the 80s, the production style changed and the songwriting style changed a bit.
Yeah.
It seemed like were you just trying to evolve to another phase, or what were you thinking?
Well, in those days, you never made the... It wasn't considered really good to make the same record 10 times in a row. You know, all the bands we grew up with, you tried to go somewhere from where you've been and that kind of thing. We were always trying to get better sound, so we were always trying new producers. And we went to Epic and said, we want to get George Martin. No, we're going to get George Martin to produce the next record. And they were like, you guys are nuts. They thought that was the worst idea they ever heard. And after Budokan, Dream Police got delayed 6 months, and the record company, Werman, was calling up going, we should take Need Your Love off there because it's on Budokan, and you should go in and cut Day Tripper or one of your other live tunes and put something on here. And we were like, no, we did Dream Police. It's in the can. We're not going back and doing this and doing this. We're not going to start chasing our tail. And they put us on, we stayed on the road, basically, and they basically just burned us right out. You know, Tom was the first one to kind of go south. He married a German model. That got really weird.
How long did that last?
His marriage?
Yeah.
Well, he married her, and 15 or 16 months later, he was out of the band. And so, I don't know, a few years after that, I think he...
Then he came back to the band.
Now, a few years after that, I think he got in a car one day and went to the airport and left town and moved across the country. And then a couple years after that, he got back in the band or something. But you know, he did an EP with his wife, and we, you know, we tried to carry on without him. You know, and we sounded like three quarters of Cheap Trick probably. And you know, things just in general went south after that. You know,
like the relationships.
Yeah, as we all got married off. You know, then suddenly your first loyalty is your wife and not the band, or I'm totally burned out, or this and that. The record company's telling you this is fucked up, or the office is going, you're broke, you got to go out and tour, or this is screwed up.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's hard enough to keep a band together, you know, and spend that much time with anybody, let alone three other people. And then, you know, once money starts coming in, then that can actually turn things sour too.
Yeah, the money was real good, so it didn't. Nothing bad really happened over money for a long time. It was mostly.
Did it feel
just,
like everybody was like being fairly compensated in the band?
Like, well, we always wondered why we weren't making more money.
You know,
of course, because we put ourselves on salary. And then
I'm saying, like, as far as the band members themselves, like, there wasn't any sort of dispute over like I deserve more. I deserve.
Oh, yes.
I did this.
A couple guys, Tom wanted more writing credits. One week he called up and said, me and Rick should be in the shadows, and it's him and Robin should be up front because it's all about sex these days. It's not music. And you two guys are just an embarrassment to the band.
Wait a second. You like sex just as much as any other guy, don't you?
Hey. No, you know, stuff with Tom went south, and we thought we knew what the hell we were doing. You know, all sorts of stuff. I mean, the same thing happened to us. It probably happens to any band. It got dicked up.
You persevered. I mean, you kept making records. You kept touring.
We kept touring because we really weren't making any money on the records. So the money was to be made was on the road.
But you weren't having to come home and work a day job at all during that period.
No, but we were never home.
Right.
We were gone 50 weeks a year.
So you were married at the time, too.
Yeah, I got married in 81.
Are you still married?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask you this. How did you make that work? This is like a thinly veiled way for me to address my own neuroses. But
I got no great advice for your marriage. No, I didn't get married till I was 30, so that probably didn't hurt, you know. And, you know, Rick got married in 69, and he's still married.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got married in 81. I'm still married. So I guess we married the right people. I don't know, you know.
Do you feel like Cheap Trick's place in culture and in music has been fairly recognized?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean.
I mean, all the band, like, again, like, so the punk rockers cite Cheap Trick as a reference. And then, you know, again, in the 90s, when alternative music started to get big, you know, lots of those artists were citing Cheap Trick as a huge influence and taking you guys out on the road and such.
Yeah, we got name checked by a lot of nice people and stuff, but you know, we were pretty nice guys too. So a lot of that was just by being nice guys, I think, and making decent records. But you know, if you're being in a band when you're famous, you know, if you believe all the good stuff, then you got to kind of believe all the bad stuff too. So.
So what was your strategy? Don't pay attention to any of it. Yeah.
Try not to believe any of it, and just try and stay true to some sort of vision if you have it. But you know, something always gets in the way, and all this. This guy's not managing as good as he could, or this guy's not booking as good as he could, or I'm partying too much, or he's partying too much, or something's going wrong. You know, there's always something that steps in. And look, you know, look someone like Tom Petty.
Sure.
He had to go into bankruptcy to get a better record deal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, maybe we all should have, or something. I don't know. You know.
A few years ago, you stopped playing with the band.
I stopped touring.
You stopped touring with them. And so then you were going to keep recording with them, and then there was an argument about that, too. And so what's the status right now?
Well, the status is there's a settlement in place, so I really can't go into too many details. But I quit touring with them, but I still own an ownership stake in the band. I still have an equity stake and stuff. So
do you have an interest in recording with the band again?
No. I will probably never record or perform with them again.
So do you talk to the other guys anymore?
No, I haven't talked to Tom or Robin probably in 5 years. And but then again, we didn't have much to say 5 years ago either.
Do you talk to Rick?
Once in a blue moon.
Does it feel hurtful that, you know, these people that were such a big part of your life are no longer in your life?
Nah. You know, it's
just like, you know, sometimes things go bad and then it's better to just cut it off, or?
No, if you know, how do bands end? You know, one could say, well, it's women or it's music or it's money or it's this or that, you know, so there you go. You know, everything comes to an end, you know, so that
what,
kind of stuff.
What is it in this case, money?
Well, we all didn't get along quite the same, and one guy is kind of running the band, and so there you go, you know.
It doesn't feel like a band anymore.
Well, it hasn't felt like a band in a while, really, but that's, a lot of bands don't feel like bands.
Right, I mean, did it feel like, you know, for the last years that you were doing it, that it was more like going to work than playing in a rock and roll band?
Nah, I just think situations change, things change. I really can't go into any details on it, but basically what it adds up to is if you got to sue someone in federal court, things obviously aren't working out too good.
Right.
And I had to go after these guys in federal court to get money owed to me. So that's all.
That's all. And then, like, on a personal level, you feel okay with where things are as far as, like, where you're at in your life right now?
Oh, I'm a happy camper. Yeah.
Yeah. It's not, you're not losing sleep over it anymore.
Hell no.
Okay.
You know, I'm not playing some county fair tonight. You know, that's okay. Well, I don't have to sit in some crappy trailer and eat bad food, but I don't get to go up on stage and have people go when they hear my name or something. Big deal. You know, I mean, it's fun to do. You know, being famous is fun, but there is a price to be paid for all of this stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of stuff. I mean.
You've played in other projects with guys like James Iha and one of the Hanson brothers. And do people seek you out, or are those things that you put together?
Well, the Tinted Windows project. Yeah, we got a call from Adam called Schlesinger called the office
from
and
Fountains
said,
of Wayne.
Said, "Yeah, I'm doing a little side project with Taylor Hanson and James, and we're looking for a drummer like Bun E. Does he know anybody?" And the office told me, and I said, "God, I love those guys. I could do this thing probably." Unless I'm the wrong age group or something. And we called them and said, "I'll do it." And they said, "Will you do it?" And I said, "Yeah, if the songs are any good." I said, "Send me the songs." So they sent me the songs, and the songs were like, "Wow." So I said, "Yeah, let's do this." So that's how that came about.
So do you have any specific creative goals moving forward?
Yeah, I'd like to do a covers record for my probably last record I'll probably ever have a chance to, like, do major noise on. And
why do you say that?
I'm going to be 64 in June, so... just by definition, my days are probably getting numbered.
Roy Haynes is 90. He's still doing it, man.
Yeah, if I do a record and I'm 90, it'll be called "Someone Please Kill Me." We have an album in the can. We're finishing up with Candy Gold. It's the John Stewart from Wilco and Rick Rizzo from 11th Dream Day and Nick Tremulous and myself and Mark Greenberg, Wilco's engineer. We've got 10 songs. We're just mixing now. I do some stuff with the Jimmies, a blues band out of Monroe. My high school band, the Pagans, we're back together practicing. Now it's Bun E. Carlos and the new Pagans. They asked me to put Bun E. Carlos on top. And I
all have, original members?
Two and two other guys our age.
Okay.
And I have a Monday night band that only plays on Monday nights from 7 to 9, about once a month.
In Rockford?
In Rockford. We do...
And where's that?
Alt country and stuff. It's at Mary's Bar, Mary's Place Bar, and... it's a couple guys that are in a band with Miles Nielsen and a couple guys I know. We all used to shoot pool together. So I mess around. I dabble.
Well, Bun E. Carlos, thank you so much for doing this.
Pleasure.
The Trap Set is produced by me, Joe Wong, along with Chris Karwowski, who also edits the program. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at The Trap Set, and visit our website, thetrapset.net, to subscribe to our show for free. If you enjoyed what you heard today, please donate to our show. If you can't afford to donate, please tell a friend and give us a good rating on iTunes. Send your feedback and guest requests to thetrapset@gmail.com.